actually nothing special is required over here. The only thing here is that now instead of only one random variable, you will have a distribution of more than one random variable. Okay, like in this case the p or the x was the number of cars. Now if I decide that two variables are there, x and y, and x be the number of cars and y be the number of, let's say, two wheelers, and I want to see the variation of these two quantities over this road junction, okay, x and y. So this becomes a case of two random variable where we will be using the probability distribution function for a bivariate problem. Okay, now the thing is that all the things that we have studied till now is also valid over here, just the thing that two variables are there now, right now. And in your case, in your GATE exam, obviously these two random variables will be independent of each other. It does not depend if the number of cars are more or if the number of two wheelers are more, then it will not affect this x or it will be not affecting by. These two are independent only, they do not have any effect on each other. Okay, now I'll directly get to a question where you can see that how to attack the problems of joint probability. We are not going anything special over this. We will be just be learning all the previous concept with regard to the two variables now. That is the only difference. Okay, so writing over the question right here. So there are two random variables, independent random variables, x and y. As I mentioned, the problem will be always of independent random variables. Now their distributions is identical, that has been mentioned, and it is given that x and y takes the value 0, 1 and 2 with the respective probability of 1 by 2, 1 by 4 and 1 by 4. You have to determine this probability, conditional probability. Okay, first of all, tell me what kind of these random variables are. Are they continuous or discrete? X and y, are they continuous or discrete? Yes, definitely they are discrete random variables. They are taking separate values of 0, 1 and 2. Okay, now please put down your pen for 2 minutes and I'll solve this question and see how it is done and then rewrite it. Okay, so first of all, let's see what is happening with x and y. So I'll draw our table like this. Okay, where in this I'll write the values of possible values of y, which is 0, 1 and 2. And in this column, I'll write the possible values of x. So I've written down possible values of x, possible value of y. Now I'll see what is the probability of getting x as 0 and y as 0. This means what? That you are getting 0, both 0 and 0. This first place over here, this denotes probability of x 0 and y 0, yes or no? Because both are varying. Okay, let's consider it is nothing but the number of cars and the number of scooters or the two wheelers. So both are 0, this is one of the case. Similarly, this place will denote probability of x equal to 0 and probability of y equal to 1 and so on. This is how you will read this table. Okay, so first of all, let's find out first probability of x equal to 0, y equal to 0. Now, because they are independent, because x and y are independent, what I can write is that probability of some x equal to xi and y equal to yi is nothing but the probability of xi into probability of yi. Why I have written so? Because this means what? That x is xi and y is yi, and whenever there is a and, you know that there is an intersection, and whenever there is an intersection of two independent quantities, then what do? You just multiply the respective probabilities. So what this is what we will do here. Because x and y are independent, I can write this to be p0 into p0, yes, and probability of 0 is given to be 1. So this will come out to be 1 half into half. Have you got it or not? So half into half because independent events and comma means this and this should occur together and condition means intersection, intersection for independent means multiplication of the respective probability. Now similarly, this means probability of x equal to 0 which is half into probability of y equal to 1 which is 1 by 4. Similarly, this means probability of x equal to 0 half and probability of y equal to 2 which is 1 by 4. Fill in the table completely. So, x equal to 1 probability is 1 by 4 and y equal to 0 probability is half. Similarly, x equal to 1, y equal to 1, 1 by 4 into 1 by 4 and x equal to 1, y equal to 2, 1 by 4 into 1 by 4. And lastly, x equal to 2 means 1 by 4 into y equal to 0 means 1 by 2. X equal to 2, y equal to 1, x equal to 2, y equal to 2. This is how we will fill this table. Okay, so I think you have got up to this point that why I have multiplied, why I have or how I have written down this table. Now let's come to the question which has been asked. This conditional probability has been asked. You don't know about the two variables, but you know that conditional probability formula can be written down like this, that it is the intersection of these two quantities and divided by the condition imposed, that is x minus y equal to 0. This is the conditional probability formula that we have already studied. Okay. Now, this means intersection means both should occur together. Okay. First of all, let's talk about the denominator. X minus y equal to 0. What does it denote? It denotes that x minus y is 0 means x is equal to y. Now, let's look in the table. What are all those cases where x is equal to y? Where x is equal to y. So, if you look carefully, these diagonal elements are nothing but the cases of x equal to y. Yes or no? In this case, x is 0, y is 0. In this case, x is 1, y is 1. In this case, x is 2, y is 2. So, what is the probability of x minus y equal to 0? It is nothing but the occurrence of either this or this or this. Yes or no? Either this will occur or this will occur or this will occur. So, OR condition means what? What do we do in OR condition? Multiply. So, what we will do? In OR condition, we add. So, we will do the addition of the respective probabilities. So, this is how we will add. So, 1 by 4 into 1 by 4 plus 1 by 4 into 1 by 4. Okay, now let's come to the numerator. Numerator means these two conditions should happen together. Means this is nothing but x equal to y. So x should be equal to y. First of all, that means either this will fall in either three of these cases. Okay, and then x plus y equal to 2. X should be equal to y also, and x plus y summation should be equal to 2 also. Which box will be the answer? First, second or third? So, x plus y equal to 2. Here, x plus y is equal to 0. Here, x plus y equal to 1 plus 1, 2. Here, x plus y equal to 2 plus 2, 4. So, definitely the middle one is your required probability because it is denoting both the cases where x plus y is 2 and x is equal to y. Yes, very good. So, the required probability here is 1 by 4 into 1 by 4. Okay, and solve this. This is 1 by 16, and if I multiply this, I'll get this as this will be 4 plus 2, 1 by 6. 1 by 6 is the right answer. Done. So, this is how you will solve a question based on what? Two variables based on joint probability. Okay, just frame this table and just look for the probability that is required. So, this was a question when x and y are discrete random variable. Now, let's look at the case when x and y are continuous random variable. Okay, so I'm deleting this question part. Till then, you can write down this answer part. Okay, last step what I did is, here it was 1 by 16. Here it was 1 by 4, 1 by 16, 1 by 16. So I taken the LCM so that 16 and 16 cancelled. So it was remaining like this. You can solve this very easily. Numerator part, okay. Numerator part, I was saying that this is a conditional probability. That means that this condition should together occur with this condition, that is intersection. That is the formula that we have seen for the conditional probability. Now, x plus y should be equal to 2 also, and x minus y should be equal to 0 also. Both of the conditions should be satisfied. Okay. Now you can see that x equal to y is occurring in these three cases. Now you just have to check among these three cases where x plus y is equal to 2. Okay. So if you look over here, x is 0, y is 0. The sum is not 2. If you look over here, x is 1, y is 1. For this case, x is 1, y is 1. Sum is coming out to be 2. While for this case, x is 2, y is 2. The sum is equal to 4. Sum is not 2. So the sum is 2 for only this case. That's why I wrote the probability. The intersection of these two is 1 by 4 into 1 by 4. Understood? Okay, now let's see this question, write down the question. Have you written down the solution of the last question? Should I remove the solution of last question? So for the case of continuous random variables, we have a curve as the distribution. Yes or no? Do you remember that? The curve will be there for the distribution. Now, we have what? We have two random variables. So I'll draw these two random variables on x and y axis like this. Okay, it has been given that it is varying from 0 to 1. X is varying from 0 to 1, so it is varying like this, and y is also varying from 0 to 1. So definitely this, according to this line only, your distribution will be varying. Okay, and what this line is? This line is known as x plus y equal to 1. Okay, yes or no? This is the equation of this line, which you can easily find it out. Okay. Now, whenever you had this question, whenever you had this kind of a question, when let's say x is less than 1, what you did? You integrated your function with respect to x and some limit, let's say minus infinity to 1. This was the case when there was a single variable. Now, what is there? Now, we have two variables, x plus y less than equal to 1. When you have one variable varying up to 1, then this is the case. But when you have two variables, then obviously you should double integrate. Now, what double integration should be done? The double integration should be done for the function, which is the probability distribution function, f of xy, and then dx dy. Yes or no? When you had just a single variable, you integrated once. But when you have two variables, you will have to do double integration like this. Now the thing is that we haven't started with the chapter of calculus, so you don't know how to double integrate. Okay, most of you don't know. The ones who know, they can integrate it, but most of you don't know. So I am just simply explaining once. If you are not able to understand also in calculus also, you can refer to this question back, and then you will be able to understand this question thoroughly. So what I have said, this means that the probability or double integration of f of xy. Okay, now the thing is, what should be the limits of integration? Okay, so we have this line as x plus y equal to 1, but what we need is x plus y should be less than equal to 1. Okay, now first of all, one more important thing, that you can't go in negative region because x is never negative, y is never negative. So when x plus y is less than 1, what do you think, which kind of area will be getting? So obviously we will be getting that particular area which is lesser than this line. That means this will be the region over which the integration should be done. Because, why? Because x and y both are positive always, and we need x plus y to be less than 1. Means for this particular region you need to do this integration. And according to this region only we will decide the limits. Now how to decide the limit? So first of all, x, if you see for x, this dx variable, you can say that x is varying from this point to this point. If I consider just a strip like this, okay. So x is varying from this x equal to 0 to this part where x is equal to 1 minus y. So the limit for x is 0 to 1 minus y. And similarly, we can find out the values for limit for y. So you can see that y will be varying from bottommost position, that is the strip can come up to this point, which is y equal to 0, and it go maximum to this line, which is y equal to 1. So 0 to 1. Again, I am telling you, you do not know how to double integrate, but we will learn this thing in calculus. So just what the thing you need to understand is this means that integration of this quantity. Okay. This is not giving you the probability because this is not your px. In the last all cases, we have x versus px graph. This is not x versus p of x. There is no probability over here. So if you are finding out the area, you are just summing up x and y, which is not required. We need to sum up the probability function with respect to x and y. That's why you can't say it is equal to the area of the triangle. Okay. Now, how to solve this integration, that we will see in the calculus part. I am just for now just solving it for you for the notes only. So I substitute f of xy as x plus y dx dy. Okay, so first integration with respect to x, so x square by 2 plus y times x, limits are 0 to 1 minus y, 0 to 1 dy. Substitute the values of x in the limits, so it will be 1 minus y whole square divided by 2 plus y into 1 minus y, and integration 0 to 1 dx. Okay, integrating over here, so 1 minus y square by 2, okay, I'm opening up the bracket, so y square plus 1 minus 2y divided by 2 plus y square by 2 minus y square, so minus y square by 2, and this will be minus y plus y, to 0, and then 1 by 2. So 1 by 2 minus 1 by 6, which is 1 by 3.33 is the answer. Okay, so I promised you that we'll be solving some questions on probability, but sorry, we couldn't find out the time. So what I'll do, as I promised you, that I'll be sharing some questions for practice. So just give me a mail so that I can share the slide with or the questions with one of you, and you can share among yourselves what are all those questions, and you can practice those. Okay. So this completes our chapter of probability, and from the next class we'll be starting with the calculus. So this is all about this chapter. If any doubt is there, you can ask right now, and then we should end this class. What are independent solutions? So if you remember, in homogeneous or sorry if in the case of infinite solutions in case of infinite solutions what you did, if you like, if you have three variables x, y, and z, what you did, you let some z as some k, then you find out x, and then you find out y in terms of k. Yes or no? So, how many variables you have to let? Like in this case, you only let one variable, which is as k. That means only one independent solutions are there. These two are becoming dependent on z. If it was the case that anyhow I am letting x1 as k1 and x2 as k2, so in this case you will be getting two independent solutions. They are not depending upon each other. You have taken two different constants, but y is depending upon k1 and k2. So this is independent solutions. Okay, now to solve this, let's say here is some minus 1, here it is 2, and here it is 1. So basically you have only one equation, which is now only one equation is there to get the solution. What you will say, let's say that z is some k1 and y is some k2, and then you will write that this is nothing but k2 plus 2k1 equal to 1, and you can solve for x. Okay, so what we did here, we did here that we had to let two variables as some constants. So the independent solutions are only two. You can choose independently what is z, you can choose independently what is y, but x is dependent upon x and y. So it depends upon the rank of your matrix AB. Rank of your matrix AB or basically A, that how many independent solutions are there. So if the total number of rows are n, then the rank of A, n minus rank of A will be the number of independent solution. Okay, this is the number of independent solution. Any other doubt? Okay then, good night all of you. I guess there are no doubts. Thank you.